All right, hello. Welcome everybody to Toby's Tech Talk. We are on episode number 42, so I want to thank you all very much. As always, I have a second monitor over here, so I'm going to be looking at that monitor. I'm going to be monitoring any questions that come in, any comments that come in, and of course, saying hello to everybody. So thank you all so much for tuning in today to Toby's Tech Talk. I do apologize we're starting just a couple of minutes late, but I'll make up for it with some awesome tips and tricks today. I want to just start off with a quick polling question to make sure that everybody is able to hear me, and then we'll get into our opening quick tip, which is the ability to change the temporary graphics color. Little cool thing that I just decided to change up this month, kind of for kicks, kind of for functionality, and I'll show you both. But before I start, let me just launch a quick poll here. Always try to launch this poll. The question is, can you hear me? So I just want to make sure that everyone can, in fact, hear me. Yes, you sound great, or you sound like you're in a cave. All right, good. I appreciate that. I am sort of in a cave. I'm here at the Prism Engineering headquarters. Not really a cave, more of my home office. So here at Prism Engineering in Horsham, Pennsylvania, broadcasting from my office. Been on the road a lot lately. I've been doing a lot of modular Toby's Tech Talk, so it's good to be back home, back here in the Horsham office. All right, here's just a quick tip. I like to start every Toby's Tech Talk with a quick tip. I hope you guys appreciate these little tips. This one, it's more of a style thing. There is a bit of functionality involved in it, which is why I changed it to begin with. But did you know you can change your temporary graphics color? And like I said, I did this for sake of functionality, but then I ended up really liking it. And it just gave me something a little bit fresh with my settings without going too crazy. I'm not trying to make the toolbars, you know, hot pink or anything like that. But just a little subtle change to my normal setup was kind of nice, kind of refreshing here. And you can see what the difference is that instead of having the traditional graphics where your temporary graphics are yellow, I changed mine to be green. And there is a functional advantage to this, and that functional advantage came in when I was working with splines and looking at curvature combs on those splines. So here, I'll show you how to change this option in just a moment, but for now, let me just change it back to what it originally was, which was kind of a darker yellow and a yellow. And now you can see that if I go to Features Extrude here, you can see what this looks like. This looks a lot more traditional, a lot more like what you're used to seeing. Now, the reason this option would be changed, the reason this would be advantageous would be that if I was to come in here and create a spline, I'm just going to make a spline that looks like this. And then I'm going to get normal too, and I'm going to make some adjustments to what's called the spline curvature combs, or I'm sorry, the spline control handle. So that means I'm going to take these points and drag these points around a little bit and just kind of grab these arrows here and use these arrows to control the spline. So not only can you control where a spline point is located, you can also control the shape of the spline by using these spline handles here. All right, but what you want to be looking out for is how smoothly the curvature is changing. Curvature is just the inverse of radius. So how smoothly is one radius transitioning into another? And the way that we do that with a spline is we right-click on it and we say Show Curvature Combs. And we can control what's called the density of the curvature combs as well as the height of the curvature combs. So here you can see height and density, adjusting that height, adjusting that density there. But when I hit the green check mark, this is the result I get. It almost looks like the curvature combs have disappeared, right? Well, they haven't disappeared. It's just that the temporary graphics color is yellow. It's that kind of very pale yellow color. So what I did was I went into my options, and in options I went to colors, and I went to I pressed T on my keyboard. That jumps to the next item that begins with a T, and I'm able to change the temporary graphics here, and I can change those temporary graphics for both the lines. So I'm making the lines kind of a darker green, and for the shaded, I like to make that a little bit of a lighter green. And when I'm done doing that, the result here you can see is that it's much easier to see my curvature combs and to see how my curvature is transitioning. So for example, in this region, it kind of remains a constant radius, and then all of a sudden begins to drop down right here. And that curvature is going to be very noticeable, especially if you were to put that thing under a light, which if you're working in a cosmetic industry, of any sort, that, you know, that's going to become a pretty important concept. So here you can see I can smooth that out a little bit more so it doesn't just immediately change radius, but instead it's got a bit more smoothness to it. And you really wouldn't see that if you were only looking at the spline. But when we examine the spline with the curvature combs, you can see it becomes very apparent, you know, when we're maybe not getting quite a desired result from our curvature, and it'd be something that'd be much harder to find when you were just looking at the spline itself. So that's kind of the background as to why I changed that color. And just on the side, maybe we can call this a bonus tip here for Toby's Tech Talk today. What I'm doing there is I'm going into my options and I'm making a change to my options for that color. And you can see because I'm running at a higher resolution, I don't have all my options available here. So I go colors, and down at the very bottom here, there should be an option that says okay, but I don't have that option right now. So this is something you'll run into if you're ever projecting. That's why I'm sharing it with you. You might think, oh, well, we're never gonna do a Toby's Tech Talk, so we're not gonna run into this. But you absolutely could run into this if you were running off of a projector that had a lower resolution. So what I'm doing then is I'm changing the color. So I went down to temporary graphics and I'm changing the color here. And then I usually just go up to general. And then once I'm on general, you can just click enter, and that'll usually equate to hitting okay. So that's a good trick that I've used over the years. You know, I'm here, I'm in colors, I want to change a color. Oh, there's no option for okay down here. Sometimes you can just do it right from here. You just click enter, and you know, it happened to work there as well. But you know, if in doubt, if it doesn't seem to work, if you're on an option, you make some changes. You know, like if I change here and I press enter, it might just select that option again. Or if I'm here, you know, it might just enter that value. So I just go back to general, and then I press enter on my keyboard, and then that closes out your options screen. So if you're ever doing a working off a projector and you've got that tighter resolution, that's a good trick you can use. So you're not up there like, oh, I can't get to the OK button, and it kind of derails your presentation a little bit. So anyhow, that's how I changed my temporary graphics color. And I did that for a surface modeling class, but I was actually happy to see after I was done doing that change that same graphics, temporary graphics function is used here when you're doing an extrusion. And like I said, it was just kind of a nice little change. You know, I've been using the software for many years. For many years, it's been that same yellow color. Here you can see that darker green for the temporary graphics lines. And there you can see that lighter green for the temporary graphics shaded. So just something you can do to your system to give yourself a little bit more variety. You know, variety is the spice of life. So it lets you kind of mix it up a little bit. Yeah, and Mike says already, good tip. It really helps when you're working with, you know, different colors or different parts with similar colors. You know, definitely a good tip you can use there. Okay, last month, this is the part from Toby's Tech Talk contest last month. Now, I do apologize. I took quite a while to get the Toby's Tech Talk video posted on YouTube. So to be fair to everybody, I'm going to wait until next month to reveal the answer to this Toby's Tech Talk contest. You can go to our YouTube page and you can find the link for that Toby's Tech Talk. I've also posted that link on our Twitter page. So if you remember last month, I ran into a little bit of trouble with the recording. What I did was I made a couple of Toby's Tech Tips or Prism Tech Tips. They're short videos, 5 to 10 minutes long, that talk about the sweep command, beginning sweep tips, middle level sweep tips, and then advanced sweep tips. And I just took those videos and tacked them onto the end of Toby's Tech Talk as well. So the video from Toby's Tech Talk last month has all that info as well. And that way you can learn how to use the sweep command and how to use your guide curve and use your guide curve to generate this shape. One thing that I like about having this Tech Talk contest and sharing it with all of you is that you're all very creative and you often come up with different techniques for generating the same model. I had a couple people tell me they did it with a sweep. I had a couple people tell me they did it with some other techniques. I'd like you to do it with a sweep. But, you know, as always, there's more than one way to get to that result. And there is a bit of a tolerance on the answer to this one. So, you know, take a look at it. If you haven't done this one yet, you can take a look at the video on YouTube. And you still have another month yet to get your answers in. There will be a new Tech Talk contest today. So I'll have a new model for you as well today that you can try to go through. So to introduce myself, my name is Toby Schnars. You can see I'm here in my my office. You can see I've got a bunch of certifications here up on the wall. Many more certifications that I've received. You know, this year I've already achieved 5 new certifications. So I really try to beat up the certification game. I try to get as many as I can because it just helps me be a more well-rounded instructor, more well-rounded applications engineer and support guy, and ultimately a more well-rounded user. You know, when you take these exams, you learn things that you might not run into in your day-to-day job. And all these orange ones here are available for all the users. The rest of these down here are primarily for the reseller, but these are all available for all the users, all the CSWP and CSWP specialist exams. And last month I announced that I'm actually hosting a CSWP online training class. It's next week. There are still some open seats, so you guys feel free to tune in to the CSWP online training class. It's $295. You can email Christine C. Malazzi at prismeng.com. You can find her email right here on the www.prismeng webpage. And you know, just click into training and you can see all of our different training options that we have for Prism Engineering training classes, including the CSWP online training class. If you want to take the class, and you want to pass the exam, this is a great way to make sure that you're prepared for that exam. And you'll learn all about what you're going to need to do to prep for it, how to take the exam, how to get a free ticket to take the exam. There's actually a promotion. You can get a free exam. You can learn all about those things just by tuning into this class next week. It's $295. It's Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. each day. So it's just kind of a two-hour block in your afternoon, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And after those 3 days, you should be prepared and ready to take that exam. So I hope to see everybody who's not a CSWP in that class next week. We do have some open seats still. We can take a few more people for that class. And every week, you know, we get questions about where do I get SolidWorks from? How do I get the full download of SolidWorks? What's the best way to install SolidWorks? So the best way to install SolidWorks is to go and get the full download of SolidWorks. If you don't know how to do this, email us, swtech@prismeng.com. We'll send you over a PDF. And you'll be ready to do that full download, and you'll get the best possible results from your SolidWorks install. I use this every single service pack. I have the full download. I always want to have the latest and greatest. I'm always going to be installing on new computers. I mean, I've even got a computer right here. Nice little small computer right here that I'm going to be installing on. And it's going to be much easier for me to do that installation. It's going to be much easier for me to do that installation because I've got that full download on an external hard drive ready to go. And I've got everything I need for SolidWorks, flow simulation, SolidWorks electrical, you know, whatever add-ins you might have, Composer, Workgroup PDM for my Workgroup PDM homies out there. Everything you need is from that full download. So email us if you need a copy of that PDF. We'll send you over all the instructions you need to download that full install of SolidWorks. And then there is a video posted online you can take a look at on how to do that full install, some really good tips and tricks on how to do that install and get the best results from your SolidWorks install. Now, as far as SolidWorks Tech Alert goes, there was a pretty major issue with SolidWorks 2015, and you want to make sure that to avoid this issue, you get up to SP 2.1 as soon as possible. Today, if you don't already have it. Of course, one of the next things I'm going to announce is that 3.0 is right around the corner. So if you wanted to wait till 3.0, that's fine. It'll probably be out this week. But there was an issue with 2.1. Make sure that you get the latest and greatest service pack installed. You can get that from that full download and make sure you get up and running with that full install as soon as possible. Okay, let's see here. 2.1 is the officially released service pack right now, but 3.0 is right around the corner. Early visibility came out, I think last week, maybe the week before. Early visibility is, you know, usually out a couple of weeks before the full version comes out. This week in tech support, got a question about what kind of computer should I get for SolidWorks? Well, this would be a good kind of computer to get for SolidWorks. Windows 7 64-bit. 8 gig to 16 gig of RAM, or more if you can, supported graphics card and a solid state hard drive. And when it comes to a supported graphics card, I mean, you can go to SolidWorks.com. Here, they bring up the website here. You can go to SolidWorks.com, and when you go to SolidWorks.com, you can see here that there's a section at the bottom that says support system requirements. So you go to support there, system requirements. And then you can learn all about, you know, the SolidWorks system requirements, even recommendations are in here and kind of some best practices. So here's what's required as far as operating systems go. Here's hardware benchmarks. So you can see some benchmarking. There used to be an article in here about, you know, some things to look for when you're speccing out a new CAD system. But, you know, there's plenty of online articles about that as well. And then, if I go back to that page that said system requirements, you can see here's the link for your graphics card drivers. So you just come in here. You know, those of you, some of you have been with me for a while, you know how to do this, but some of you who are a little newer to Toby's Tech Talk, you can see you can get in here. Once you get in, you can go to what type of computer you have. So me, I have a Dell. I have a Precision M4800. And I have this one, the K2100M. Let's see. Let's find out together. So we right-click on our desktop, we go to Screen Resolution, this is Windows 7, and then we go to Advanced Settings. Yes, I have the NVIDIA Quadro K2100M. And then if we go to Properties here, we can see what driver we're currently running off of. So my driver's from back in September. They've probably got a newer driver since I installed mine. I should probably get up a little bit on my driver. How would I know if I was having problems with my driver? If you notice what we call graphical artifacts, so if you take a dialog box and you move it around and a ghost of that dialog box remains behind, or if you launch a new program and then you launch SolidWorks and a ghost of the new program remains on the SolidWorks screen, that's an indicator that your graphics may be a problem, and it might be able to be resolved just by either changing a setting or maybe changing your driver. But this is where you can go at solidworks.com to see if the problems may be a little bit more deeply rooted, specifically if it's with the card itself. So if I go on here and I say Dell M4800 K2100, and I say I'm running SolidWorks 2015 on Windows 7 64-bit, I say show results, and it comes up with results that say there's limited support, or there's significant stability issues with this card, then I know that I need to update my card. Maybe if I don't find, if I get to this screen here where it says SolidWorks version and I only have an earlier version, that could also indicate that maybe there's some limitations. So let's say I have a Dell M4400. That was my old laptop. And I say graphics card Quadro FX 770. And look, SolidWorks 2015 isn't listed here. So there's not a supported graphics card driver combination for SolidWorks 2015. And that's what that indicates. So all that info is right there at SolidWorks.com. If you're looking for a new computer, looking for a new setup, that's a place you can go to look and get some good information. Okay, and 2014 is out. It's been out for a while. It's on SP5. I still have it installed here. I still like 2014. I also do a lot of support with 2014, which is the real reason why I have it installed. But it's a great solid release, 2014 SP5. It was released at the end of October last year. Some interesting notes with 2015. There's no more 32-bit support at all. The only exception to that is that they made a special edition of e-drawings. But this special edition of e-drawings can only open, the special edition of e-drawings can only open SolidWorks files. It can open SolidWorks 64-bit files. It cannot open e-drawings files. So if you generate an e-drawings file using e-drawing 64-bit, you're not going to be able to open it with the 32-bit version. If you generate a SolidWorks file, you will be able to open it with this special version of eDrawings. So that would be applicable to companies that have a shop floor, and the shop floor has computers that are just used for viewing, and that's it. So they're just basic, bare bones 32-bit Windows machines. Those machines could take advantage of this 32-bit version of eDrawings. And it ships on two DVDs now. This is yet another reason why the full download is valuable, because you don't need to do the switcheroo game with your multiple DVDs. You can just have one single full download that you can work off of. And there's no more 2D emulator. That was a plugin in SolidWorks that allowed us to kind of work like AutoCAD with a command line at the bottom. That plugin's not there anymore. Couple of changes with 2015. And the other big change that I mentioned last month, but I want to mention this again just in case anybody wasn't tuned in last month. If you use any Express products, like for me, I use DriveWorks Express a lot. So if I go here to Tools, Express Products, DriveWorks Express, I'm presented with this window. And this window is telling me that DriveWorks Express is an introductory version of the fully featured DriveWorks to enable DriveWorks Express, access DriveWorks Express tutorials, and learn more about DriveWorks. Visit my.solidworks.com/express. If your computer does not have internet access, you can visit my.solidworks.com from another computer to receive your Express product code by email and enter it below. So the lesson here is that if you use Simulation Express or DriveWorks Express or DFM Express or any of the other Express products, so if I go in here to Tools, Express Products, you can see I've got Flow Simulation Express. Simulation Express. So these are all totally free products. But if you use these products, make sure that you activate them before you go off-site or before you go somewhere that maybe doesn't have network access, or else you're going to get to that location and then you're going to be like, oh no, I need to access my code. Maybe you can log in from your phone and get your code, but it's better if you just have that ahead of time. So if you plan on using an Express product during the 2015 release, get that code now rather than waiting until you absolutely need it. So where do I find out all my news about SolidWorks? Well, once again, I go to SolidWorks.com. I have a bookmark here, SolidWorks.com. And then when I go into SolidWorks.com, I go up to the top here where it says Login. And then I go and I log in here to the SolidWorks customer portal. I enter my username and password. And once I log into that customer portal, you can see here on the right, there's lots of cool SolidWorks news here. Lots of good SolidWorks news here. Tips, tricks, news, all kinds of cool stuff here. Monthly newsletter. So really good stuff here, SolidWorks.com. A great place to go and get some good news, tips, and tricks about the SolidWorks software. I want to also mention that the SolidWorks World videos are now available. Usually I'll just Google SolidWorks World to find those videos. So if I just Google here, SolidWorks World, and then take a look at my results. So you can see SolidWorks World Proceedings. And then down here, you can see presentations and videos. And you can search here. It says search by presentation title. So I'll just search for Schnars here. Oops, no, presenter name, Schnars, not title. And then you can see surfacing for beginners. And the whole video of what we did at SolidWorks World has been posted. So if you want to learn more about surfacing, beginner surfacing for beginners, if you want to go through and you want to learn all about how to do surfacing in SolidWorks, you know, that's a great place to start. And that's just one of many, many, many available presentations. Simply Artist, How to Be a Simulation Artist. Here, 12 different ways to create inner part relations in 2015. Three ways to create cable harness drawings. 5.5 things you didn't know you could do with EPDM bombs. A hands-on experience with SolidWorks simulation. A piece of cake. Fill, loft, boundary, and sweep. So, I mean, this is an awesome resource for tips and tricks for using the SolidWorks software. I mean, if you could watch one of these a day, you would get actually more experience than somebody who actually went to SolidWorks World, because multiple presentations take place simultaneously. So, if you went to SolidWorks World, you wouldn't have the opportunity to watch every single event. So be sure to check that out. SolidWorks World videos of the proceedings have been posted. Now, as far as Prism Engineering news and events go, you can go to our website. It's www.prismeng.com. So I'll show you this website. We're getting a new website soon. We're pretty excited about it here at Prism Engineering. But www.prismeng.com, and then you can click on events. You can see all of our upcoming events, live events and online events. So additive manufacturing open house, come in and take a look at our 3D printers. The webinar we're in today, Toby's Tech Talk, webinar on harness design with SolidWorks Electrical, Simulation Tools Expo, all kinds of cool stuff in here that, you know, you can come and you can visit us live, or you can come online depending on what type of event it happens to be. And one of the newer events that we're putting together here, and it's going to be announced. It hasn't officially been announced yet. So you guys, Toby's Tech Talk, you guys are the first ones to find out about this new event, is the SolidWorks Prism Engineer, or I'm sorry, not SolidWorks, the Prism Engineering Summer School, Reform Your Design and Manufacturing Skills. So you can see here on this slide, this is a self-paced training course delivered to your inbox weekly, featuring CAD, CAM, and 3D printing courses. There's no cost involved. It's self-paced. You're going to get an email every week about the newest lesson. It's got a quiz following each of the weekly content. And the first 25 people to complete the requirements get a $100 coupon off of an upcoming live Prism Engineering training class. So this is free training, and you get a coupon to attend some live training here at Prism Engineering. And you get a certificate at the end of the class as well. And I'll just show you here the link. If you want to take a look at kind of the beginning of the website, you can, if this is something that sounds interesting to you, take a screenshot or take a moment and copy down that link. And I'll just leave that up there for a moment. And then I'll show you what the page looks like that link goes to. So let me go here, Prism Engineering Summer School. So once you go to that link, you can just enter your information, no charge for this class, and then you'll receive emails about, you know, the weekly classes. It's kind of like a weekly online tutorial, essentially. And then when you're done, you get a nice certificate saying you finished the Prism Engineering Summer School, which is, again, it's just CAD, CAM, and 3D printing information. Just learn a little bit more about the industry, about, you know, maybe you're an expert in the CAD side, but you're a little bit weaker in the machining side or in the 3D printing side. This will give you an opportunity to get a little bit more well-rounded for, you know, some of the other areas of your industry. So it's a pretty cool concept here that Liz and the other members of the team are working on, and I'm excited to see how it turns out. Maybe I'll see some of you guys in summer school, right? You guys remember that movie, Summer School? That's a great movie. Long time ago, though. If you guys have a Twitter account, you probably have not seen Summer School, right? So you can check me out at my Twitter account, at Toby Schnars. Haven't posted too much on there recently. I've been a little bit tied up with some other projects I've been working on, but I'm getting back into it now, posting a little bit more on there. So check it out. If you're not following me, go ahead and sign up. You can follow me. And that way, whenever I post a new tech tip or a webinar or an event or whatever it is we're doing, you'll get notification of it right on your phone. Some upcoming users groups. There was just a users group last month at the Marisug users group at the Horsham Library. I'm not sure when the next one is, but I expect it to be in about 2 months. So if you're in the Horsham area, you want to come out, meet some other SolidWorks users, hang out with some of the Prism people. We're usually at the Marisug one. It's right down the street from us. Come on out. We'd love to see you. It's at the Horsham Library on Babylon Road. There's also going to be a June 17th users group meeting up at the Lehigh Valley area. That one's held at LTRIC, the Lehigh Carbon Community College. So, you know, if you live up in the Lehigh Valley area, again, that's an awesome place to go. You know, you get to meet other SolidWorks users. You get to meet other SolidWorks users. You get to network. You get to learn some free skills, you know, some tips and tricks. And most importantly, you get to have free pizza or other food that they have at these users groups. So free food, awesome, awesome way to spend the night. There's also one down in South Central New Jersey. It's been put on hold a little bit because of the user group leader had been working on some side projects, but I think he's going to get back into it next month. So if you're in South Central New Jersey, be sure to check that out. These are all posted on the SolidWorks website, so you can look at the users group information on there. And then the Eastern Shore users group is also another awesome users group down in Maryland on the Eastern Shore. So you can check that out as well. Okay, this month, monthly modeling contest. You guys ready? Drum roll, please. Here comes the model. I'm going to make this full screen. What you guys can do is you can press print screen on your keyboard. If you press print screen on your keyboard, that will take a screenshot. Then you can go into a program like Paint, and you can do a paste command, and you can paste that down. And so you can see here that the material for this part is brass. The mass density of brass is 0.0085 gram per cubic millimeter. That's right out of the SolidWorks software, so I'm not throwing you a curveball here. That's what the default brass material is for SolidWorks. The result answer is going to be in grams. I'm looking for a precision at zero places. You can email tschnars@prismeng.com with the subject TTT-042 with your answer, and the tolerance for that is going to be plus or minus 3 grams for that answer. And so you can see what this part looks like. It's got a bit of taper coming from the bottom up. The dimensions there are shown at the bottom to the sharp corners. And then the corners are all filleted, and they all have kind of a different attribute to their fillet at the corner. And we're going to learn a little bit more about that today in our Toby's Tech Tip lesson on working with corner fillets, working with fillets, the fillet feature in the SolidWorks software. So, you know, be sure to look at that. Some of those different notes on there, like, for example, that view that's on the far right, which represents the bottom of the model, the 5 millimeter fillet and the shell are omitted from that view for clarity. So just, you know, take a look at that. Just notice that. Guess maybe I shouldn't say shell here. It's kind of giving you a little bit of a tip there, right? But hopefully you guys can figure out if it says 2 millimeter wall thickness typical. You know what kind of a command to use there. You're not going to sweep that thing as a thin feature around the outside, right? You know what to use there. All right, here we go. Let's take a look at the fillet feature in SolidWorks. Fillet feature in SolidWorks, right? It's been around for a long time. Most people just use the first one, constant size fillet. It's a good one to use. A lot of people know how to use that command, constant size fillet. Even just the constant size fillet, I could probably talk about for an hour. Even just the different options that are in there in the constant size fillet. But there's a lot of other commands that are available for the fillet command. There's a variable size, a face fillet, and the full round fillet as well. And each of them have got a ton of options in them. So what I want you guys to see here is that in SolidWorks 2014, these were set up with what are called radio buttons. Right? If you guys remember the movie Summer School, you probably know what a radio button is. It's in the old days, back in my day, when we had a radio, a car stereo, there were actual physical buttons you would push in, and that would represent your radio station presets, and the little needle indicator would actually jump to that location. It was really cool. But you can only push one down at a time. So you can see here, just like that, with these radio buttons in programming, you know, that's how they get their name. You can only press one of these down at a time. All right. So in the 2014 version of the software, it's a constant size. That's been moved to an icon, variable radius icon. The fillet here has got an icon, and then the full round fillet has an icon too. So, you know, just look out for that when you're seeing me working in 2015 on these fillet commands. Just want you to know why it might look a little bit different from your software. All right, so we've got this block that we created earlier. Let's fully define this bad boy. You guys know I like to fully define every time. Very important to me. A concept that is near and dear to my heart. So I'm going to put a corner-to-corner line here. I'm going to say make that midpoint. And then I'm just going to take this guy here and just bring him in a little bit, like so. And you know what? I'm going to actually leave that vertical. Leave that as a rectangle. For this example, it should be fine. And I'm going to put a dimension on here. So I'll make that dimension 100. And I'll throw a dimension here. We'll make that 150. And I'm going to extrude. And it's already extruded. I forgot because I edited the feature. So I'll make that a height of 55 millimeters. And then I'm going to make another rectangle here. This time, since I'm making it new, I'll start at the center and move my mouse out. And then because of how I've got my options set, I can just type in the value for this guy. So I'll make him 60 by 9, make him by 110. Okay, and I'm going to extrude, so S key extrude, and I'm going to bring that guy out. Look at that nice green color. I like that. I like that green color. Make that 35. And then I'm going to take this face here, begin a sketch. I'm just going to do an offset entities here. So offset entities. Okay, there's some more of that green color. Man, I like that color. And I'm going to make that 15 offset to the inside, and then I'm going to S key extrude cut, and I'll bring that down to a depth of 50 millimeters so it goes down in there. All right, cool. So a question came in here. I'm still using 2012. Which features aren't available to me? I'll talk about some of those features, Larry. Great question. I'll try to make note of you know, what's going to be available in 2012, what's going to be available in 2015, you know, 2014. So I'll try to indicate that as I'm going through the presentation. So first of all, we're going to go to Features, Fillet, and we're going to start out with this very first option here, which is the Constant Size Fillet. And the constant size fillet, one thing that I want everybody to know about it to maybe start using is that when you use a constant size fillet, you can click on this face and then you can move your mouse here and you can see you get these different flyout menus. Now, I don't think this was there in 2012, Larry. I think this came out in 2013. But this is a really, really nice new enhancement to the software. You can see that if I put my mouse here, it gives me some definitions: connected to start loop, connected to start face, internal to feature, right feature. This one is all edges on the model, and then this one is all convex edges on the model. Let's say I pick that one. So you can see it got all my edges, except it didn't get these ones here. Right? It didn't get these ones on the inside, so all my convex edges as opposed to all edges on the entire model. But that saved me having to go through and pick and pick and pick and pick and pick and spend forever, you know, picking my different edges. So where I use that one most often is if I'm making a little bit of a larger radius kind of on the outside edges here, you know, I might pick this, or I might even pick this. There you can see I got 8 edges for the price of 1. Pretty good time saver there. I mentioned last month that the constant radius fillet also gives you the option to select what's called a variable radius. Now, I'm just going to review this briefly. If you really want to get into this a lot, a multiple radius. If you really want to get into this a lot, you can take a look back at my tech talk from last month. But the basic concept is that I could pick this edge here and I could pick this edge down here, and I could assign them different radii values. Now, normally I would discourage you from doing this. I wouldn't want to have a feature that's got multiple radius values in it. I would just make it two separate features. Okay, but there is one spot where this really is valuable, and it's pretty much the only way you can do this. And that spot is that I can select 1, 2, 3 separate edges, and I can have them all with a different radius value and all coming together in the corner there. And the reason this would be important or valuable is because then in that corner, I can use this option here. It's called setback parameter. And with setback parameter, what we're doing is we're controlling where that radius starts relative to that corner point. So I can say I want this to have a setback parameter here of 15 out to the 5 millimeter fillet, and I want it to have a setback parameter here of 20 out to or down to that 10 millimeter fillet, and maybe 25 out here to that 20 millimeter fillet. Setback parameter. And when we're done, even though it looks very patchy there, if we were just to turn off edges in shaded mode, you can see it actually is a pretty nice smooth blend in that corner. We could also use commands like evaluate curvature to evaluate what's going on with the curvature in that corner and also evaluate zebra stripes. And we can see when we run that thing with zebra stripes, it looks pretty clean. Not as clean as a continuous curvature fillet, but pretty darn clean. So those are some things you can do with a fillet command within the constant fillet radius option, within the constant fillet radius option. So let me just roll back here to before I created that fillet on there. And next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to perform what's called a split command. So I'm going to take this right plane here and I'm going to choose the command insert features split. And I'm going to split this geometry using my right plane, and I'm going to choose to keep both of these bodies. So now I've got two separate solid bodies, solid body one, solid body two. Let me go to insert features, move copy, just to make it really clear what's going on here. Two separate, it's like a magic trick. You're going to separate the woman in half, right? Two separate solid bodies there. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to apply a fillet here to this face, and that fillet is going to be a 20 millimeter constant radius fillet. No setback parameter, no additional options. And then I'm going to apply another fillet to this face here. And this fillet that I'm going to apply to this face here is going to be known as a conic fillet. So here you can see that when I go in and I apply a conic fillet, and this is something that was added in SolidWorks 2014. When I go into a conic fillet, the way that I get there is I go down to profile. So here where it says profile circular, meaning it's just a constant radius throughout the entire duration, I can change that to either conic row or conic radius. And if I go to an end view here, we can see that we then get what's called a row value number. That's what this number is over here on the left. It's called your row value. And as that number increases, you can see that as that number increases, what happens is the radius out on the edges gets larger and the radius in the middle gets tighter. And as that number decreases, you can see the opposite happens. The radius out on the corners gets larger and the radius down in the middle gets larger, tighter down in the corners, larger here in the middle. So what's the 20 millimeters indicate when we're working with a conic row? And actually with a number of different fillets that are not a constant circular radius, it's representing this distance here. You can see that it's still starting at that same point. So if this guy has a radius of 20, you know, the constant radius fillet is a radius of 20, it's coming over 20 millimeters. Well, that means that the start and the bottom on a 90 degree corner are going to be 20 millimeters off from the corner. Same thing with our row value radius. So if I make that a row value of 75, you can see we end up with this result. Okay, we got a before and an after. Maybe let me just take the color of this body here and change it so we can see what our constant is. So let's say low gloss, green. Actually, maybe whatever. I've already committed to it. Make that low gloss green. Let me just change that color a little bit. Appearance of that body. Change that to an orange. So that's what's known as a row value fillet. Now another fillet type that we have available, let me put another constant radius fillet on here. So this is going to be circular, and I'll just make that a little bit larger, 30 millimeters. Another fillet type that we have available, and this is actually all still constant, this is something that was added in 2015, is the ability to tweak between symmetric and asymmetric for our fillet type. And what this is essentially is it's a partial ellipse fillet. So let me get normal to this end view here. And you can see exactly what's happening here. We've got our radius one and our radius two. So if our radius one is at 30, that means starting from this lower corner here, we're gonna be starting 30 down and then we're gonna be coming up with our asymmetric fillet. And then from radius two, we're gonna be going out to, let's say 15. So half that distance, we hit the green check mark. And you can see that the shape that's generated here is a partial ellipse. And that's essentially what we're doing here. We're generating a partial ellipse for our fillet here. So if I wake up this point, see, I'm having a hard time inferring that point, but and you can see an ellipse tool. If we brought it over, there we go. So that's what's known as an asymmetric fillet, and that was something new in 2015, but it's really cool that you can do it as a fillet feature because, you know, here we're working with very prismatic geometry, but that's not going to be the case. More than likely, you're not going to be working with prismatic geometry. You're going to be working with drafted faces, with curved faces, and the ability to get in there and maybe, you know, how many times have you been working in SolidWorks and you end up with a shape that you can fit the fillet in on the lower edge, but on the upper edge you run out of room, right? This would be a great solution for that. You can just go in and make it an elliptical fillet instead of making it a constant radius fillet. So you use that option asymmetric to control that. Now I want to talk briefly here about the ability to view curvature. So I mentioned before that curvature is going to be the inverse of radius. So if you remember this radius here, well, let's take this one here because the math will be a little bit easier. This radius here has a radius of 20. So if we look at our curvature on that face, you can see that the curvature is at a constant value of 0.5. I know that's a little bit hard to see on the screen, but let me just see if I can blow that up real quick. So I'm going to do print screen. I'm going to go paint, control V to paste that in there, and then I'm going to just blow that up a little bit. Okay, so hopefully you guys can see that. So what I did was I just took my mouse and I put my mouse in this region right here. And when I put my mouse in that region, it tells me what the curvature is and what the radius of curvature is. So radius is 20, so the curvature is going to be 1 over 20 or 0.05. What'll happen is over in this region here, you can do the same thing. You can hold your mouse over this region and it'll tell you what the curvature is. And you can see that the curvature in this region, because it's a row value fillet, it's starting out much more straight, starting out with that very larger radius, and then it's blending into the tighter radius in the corner and then blending back out to that larger radius. So you can see here, again, if I hold my mouse over it, a little hard to see on the stream or on the webcast, but you can see here that I am getting some values for curvature. And as I move my mouse up through, that curvature value is changing and representing the inverse of my radius. So black here is curvature zero. It's a flat surface. This green being all solid means that it's one radius throughout the entire fillet. This going from blue to green back to blue means that it's changing radius as it goes through the fillet. And you can see the same thing here with our elliptical fillet. The curvature value is changing as it moves through. The other tool we can use to evaluate curvature is what's called zebra stripes. And with zebra stripes here, you can see very clearly where an edge is beginning and ending. Even if I had edges turned off in shaded mode, when I turn on zebra stripes, you can see really clearly where an edge begins, where curvature begins and where it ends. This represents the phenomenon of taking your parts and holding them up to the light. If you've ever worked in cosmetic or an industry where appearance is extremely important, what they'll do is they'll take your geometry, your product, and they'll kind of hold it up to the light, and they'll look over it, and they'll look at the curves, and they'll say, oh no, look at this right here. No, that's supposed to be smooth. It's not smooth enough. And you'll look at it, and you'll say, what are you talking about? It's tangent. Smooth, right? No, it's not smooth enough. I want that to be smoother there. I can see the edge still, right? And this is what you can do within the software to simulate that. You can go to evaluate. You can turn on zebra stripes. Evaluate zebra stripes. And once you go to evaluate zebra stripes, you can see here, oh yeah, you know what? I can see that it's not smooth between those. So what can we do to smooth it out between those regions? Well, one technique that we can use to smooth it out between those regions is what's called a face fillet with continuous curvature. So we've already talked about what curvature is, right? Curvature is another way of measuring radius, essentially. It's the inverse of radius. Well, here I'm going to go to my fillet command, and in my fillet command, I'm going to choose this option here, which is called a face fillet. And with the face fillet option, what you do is you pick a face here, come over to the box and pick your next face. You pick a face here, and you can see that you're able to get a blend between those two faces. And currently, that blend is set to constant radius, so it's symmetric for the profile or the fillet method, constant radius. And then down here, the profile is set to circular, and we can make it conic row, conic radius. But we also have this option here, curvature continuous. So this is going to be 30 millimeter radius with curvature continuous, which means it's going to start 30 millimeters down from the top. It's going to end 30 millimeters in. But with curvature continuous turned on, what we're able to do is we're able to examine our curvature, and we're able to see that the face of this fillet actually starts out black. At the beginning of this fillet, it starts out with a curvature value of 0, and then it begins to blend curvature up through. It then ends up with a curvature of 0 as well. So let's see how these two fillets compare to one another when we look at them under that scrutiny of that lighting. And you can see here that as I now rotate my view and I rotate and examine the curvature continuous fillet compared to the zebra stripe fillet, it's really obvious where the face of the zebra stripe fillet begins and ends. With the curvature, it's not nearly as obvious, and when you inspect it with your mouse, you can see that you might actually be surprised where that face begins, because the face itself actually begins a little bit black. A little bit flat. So that's the concept of curvature continuous compared to just tangency. With curvature continuous, it's actually a variable radius fillet. It's not or variable radius profile, I should say. The profile does not remain one consistent radius throughout the entire transition. It starts very flat up top, then it comes off with that variable radius, and then it comes back down here to the bottom flat once again. Now, another technique that you can use when it comes to working with a variable radius fillet, when it comes to working with a face fillet, I'm getting ahead of myself here because I'm going to show you a variable next, is the ability to create what's called a hold bind for that face fillet. And a hold bind will also create a variable profile in your fillet. So let's say, for example, I wanted to create a split line here. So that's a spline, and then I'm going to use the command curve split line. And I'm going to take that spline and I'm going to use it to generate what I call an artificial edge. No material was added, no material was removed, but a new edge was created right here. Now I can perform a face fillet. So I'm going to say fillet, face fillet. I'm going to fill it from here. And if you take note of my mouse here, I'm just going to blow this up as well. Using some really advanced functionality here to blow up this stuff, print screen, and then dumping it into paint. But if you take notice of my mouse, oh, my mouse didn't come through in that print screen. All right. Well, if you take notice of my mouse here, when I pick that first face, my mouse changes to represent an advanced icon. And, since it doesn't seem to be showing up in the stream either, I'll just save that for later. I'm going to pick, just discard what I said a moment ago. I'm going to pick the first face. I'm going to move over here to my box and pick the second face. And then, instead of putting in a radius here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull down this menu here where it says symmetric, and I'm going to say I want to create this face fillet using what's called a hold line. And now this is going to be my hold line, this spline here. And when I choose that hold line, you can see that SolidWorks is now going to create my face fillet starting at that hold line and then running up to this top face here. Pretty cool stuff, huh? Now, another thing that we can do with that hold line is we can actually create two separate hold lines. So let's say I come up here to this top face and I create a line that goes at an angle, like so. And I say curve split line. So I'm going to say curve split line. And then I say I want this face here to be split. And I roll forward to my fillet. And now it errored because that face ID changed a little bit. So I'm going to say, I don't want this face, I want this face here. And I want to use a hold line. And then for my profile, for my hold line, I'm going to say I want to use a second hold line here. And then for my profile, I'm going to use curvature continuous. How cool is that? So I'm able to go in there and I'm able to explicitly declare where I want the fillet to start, in this case on a straight line, and where I want the fillet to end, in this case on a spline. And SolidWorks is able to calculate that using a spline as a profile, curvature continuous for my face constraint, and I'm able to generate that fillet in just a couple of clicks. And that's what's known as an advanced face fillet. It's a face fillet with what's called a hold line. Pretty cool stuff, huh? Now, a question came in here, and the question says, what happens when you try to pull dimension on a drawing for these different fillet options? And that's a great question, Terry. And the answer is, you're not realistically going to be able to define this using a 2D print. This is really going to be for an application where you're going from the part to the CNC. You're taking the 3D model, you're handing that off to the MasterCam guys, and then they're going to CNC the model. And then when it comes to inspection on the tail end, you're going to use the model as your inspection profile, and then you're going to touch off on it with a probe to see if the physical part is meeting the inspection criteria? So it's a great question, and when it comes to geometry like this is really getting into more of a lofty, swoopy consumer product design where you're not going to run into that as much, where they actually are working from a drawing. Instead, they're going to be working directly from the model. So I know that's not the best answer. I mean, the only other thing you could really do would be to define, you know, like with a conic row, would be to define the start and the end, in this case being 20 millimeters from the edge, and then define what the conic itself is. You know, it's got a row value of 0.75, but that's the only other option you'd really have there. Okay, a couple of other fillets I want to show you here. Probably just one more fillet, and then we'll end the presentation today. But the last fillet I want to show you here is the ability to do fillet. And I'm going to say here that I'm going to do variable fillet. And with a variable fillet, what you do is you click your edge. So here's my variable fillet edge here. And when you click your edge, you say that I want the fillet at the start to be 5 millimeters. And at the end, I want it to be 15 millimeters. And you can see that the result of the fillet is that it creates this shape. And you might notice that when it comes off of the original face, it's almost coming off normal too on this original face here. And then it's blending up and then coming off here at the tail end normal too as well on the 15 millimeter side. So when that occurs, that's a phenomenon of this option being selected, smooth transition. So there's an option over here on the left that says smooth transition. If you change that to straight transition, then the fillet starts at 5 millimeters and makes a straight run all the way up here to 15 millimeters. So you've got the option for smooth transition, and you've got the option for straight transition. And that's what the difference is between those two options. Now, along the edge of the variable fillet, what you've got are these little nodes. And if you click on one of those nodes, you'll see that you've got the ability to input additional values there. So here you can see that at the 50% mark, I decided to input a value of 2 millimeters. And there is a percentage rating here, so I could say I want that to be at 30%. So I want it to come in at 5, go down to 30, and then go up to 15 millimeters. And I want that to be a smooth transition. And back to Terry's question, good luck defining that on a drawing. I don't know how you're going to really clearly define that on a drawing, but that is, again, something that would probably go straight from the model to the CNC to get the metal cut for that mold. So the main thing about variable radius that I want you to take away from this presentation is this concept of the ability to have multiple points to control where those points are located, either with a drag and drop like what I'm doing here, or you can click on the line, the edge, and it'll have these little nodes on it, and you can click on these nodes here, and when you click on those nodes, you'll get a new call out for those nodes. And the other thing I want you to take away here is this concept of a straight transition versus a smooth transition. The smooth transition is going to come off normal to the edge and then blend up to that upper edge and end up normal to. The straight transition is just going to go straight up through. Smooth transition, straight transition. All right, and I think that's going to cover it for today. We talked about the ability to add continuous curvature, talked about the constant radius fillet, we talked about the ability to add a conic fillet, and we also talked about the ability to add a variable radius fillet. And there's a lot more to it than that. I mean, we've also, you know, something that we didn't talk about today, but I just want to mention briefly here, is the ability to make a full round fillet. This is another really cool tool in the SolidWorks software. Here I'm going to do an extrusion. And when I do this extrusion, I'm going to apply some draft here. So I'm going to draft inward like so. All right, so you see how that thing's tapering down, that pyramid is tapering down there. Well, we can do what's called a full round fillet. And a full round fillet has three selection boxes here. Selection box one, come over here and I pick selection box two. This face that I picked here is going to actually be completely removed and replaced with a curved face. And then selection box three here. And so there you go, there's our full round fillet. That middle face that I selected is actually completely removed. And if we were to evaluate the curvature on that, we would see that this actually is a variable radius fillet. The radius value is changing along the face of the fillet here. It's not a constant radius throughout that fillet because of the draft that I put on those faces. That's fine, you can still do that with a full round fillet, and it's a really nice clean way to get rid of that geometry, because then if I was to go back and edit this sketch and change the geometry of the sketch here, I can be confident that that full round fillet is still going to update properly. Good stuff, right? Good stuff with the fillet command. As always, I want to thank you guys for tuning in today. A lot going on there. We talked about the constant radius fillet. We talked about the variable fillet. Talked about the face fillet a little bit. Hold lines. Hold lines are really cool in SolidWorks. And of course, the full round fillet. So get out there. Try to use some of those. Look a little bit more into your fillet options and try to learn a little bit more about what's going on with the fillet command. It's a pretty powerful command in the software. It's an old one, but there's a lot going on in there. If anybody has any questions, I'll be sticking around for a couple of minutes. Otherwise, I want to thank you all so much for tuning in. Thanks, Robin. Take care. Thanks, Terry, for the compliment. Appreciate it. Feel free to sign out. You can put something in the question answer just to say goodbye. See you, Tim. Thanks for tuning in. Appreciate it. All right. Thanks, Tom. As always, thanks, guys. If you guys have any other questions, you can ask them now, or you can always email us, swtech. All right, Joe. Thanks very much. Take care. Cheers. Thank you very much, Ying. Good seeing you here again. Tony, thanks for tuning in. Appreciate it. All right, Randall, thank you. Thank you very much. Perry, great seeing you in here today. Dave, good seeing you. Thanks for tuning in. All right, Tony, thanks for tuning in. Glad that you were able to tune in today. First time watcher. All right. Thanks, Anthony. Chad, what's up, Chad? Good to see you. Say hi to Brian. I saw him last week. I know he's going to be one of your new guys, Chad. So say hi to him for me. Craig, thank you very much. Appreciate the compliment. Take care. And Tom, Chad, Tom says hi to you. We're all just saying hi to each other here on Toby's Tech Talk. Webinars on Composer. Anthony, take a look at the Prism Engineering website. I don't know if there's any posted on there right now, but they will be coming up. And I'll also post about them on my Twitter account. All right, Steve, thanks for tuning in. And Tom, Chad says hi back to you. And let's see here. The summer school information. Yep, no problem, Michael. I'll put that up again. Let me just roll back to that screen. All right, Krishen, thanks very much for tuning in. There you go. Here's the link to it. It's Michael, it's not on our website yet. So it's not on our website yet, but it'll be lit. You can get to it through that link there. It'll be on our website in a couple of days. But you learn about stuff first when you tune into Toby's Tech Talk.